Step. Come on. Harry, what are you doing here? You're supposed to be on vacation.
Yeah, Paul called. There's something going on in the Northern Cascades.
Les Boheem, who had wrote Daylight, and I were friends, and I called Les and I said, I've got a great idea for a movie, a volcano movie. And Les said, I'm not sure that's a good idea. And for almost a year, we talked about whether it was a good idea or a bad idea.
And when the script came along, it just seemed like there was a lot of, you know, I just liked the character. I thought that, you know, a geologist would make a great subject for a movie.
We decided to offer the picture to Roger, who was in the process of taking a picture of Paramount. And we basically gave Roger overnight to decide whether we wanted to do our movie. What we didn't know about Roger was that he had been a geologist and knew a lot about volcanology.
One of the things Roger's bringing to the project is his passion for the subject matter. He is truly passionate about rocks and volcanoes and all the things they do.
As a student, I studied geology, and for quite a while I was going to be a geologist. And it was really only the allure of photography and the motion picture business that lured me away from being a geologist. But my passion for the subject still, you know, lives on strong, and that was a real reason, I think, that I decided to do this movie.
Roger's eye is his talent. Roger has spent a long time setting up a scene, and as a producer, sometimes it can be somewhat frustrating. And then you see what it looks like, and you don't care how long it took.
Making a movie like this isn't a one-man band. You know, it's not me. It's an enormous group of people, very talented people, all sort of pooling their energies and talents and enthusiasm and creativity.
There can only be one vision on a picture, and that vision is the director's vision. So everyone else on the movie supports that vision. The props department supports that vision, the wardrobe department supports that vision, the director of photography, the production designer. And the producer has to support everyone else in supporting the vision of the director.
What I love about Roger is he likes ideas. He likes all of us to think and put together situations that might work for him. I mean, we all start with a script. We start with him. We start with his requirements. And I think build on that, from me to special effects, to set decorating, to camera, to everybody. I think what Roger does real well is he uses the things, the people, the ideas, everything around him very, very well.
We had a lot of expertise in keeping this show rolling. A big show like this takes an enormous amount of organization, and how good the organization is very important.
I sent you up here to have a look around, not to scare the hell out of the city council.
Yeah, I know, Paul, but two people are dead. Recommending an alert seemed the only responsible thing to do.
The way the system is set up these days, a producer's job and a director's job can often be fairly diametrically opposed. That will cause a lot of chaos on a movie if those two forces don't pull together and create some kind of unity.
The studio gave us a very short list of people they'd make the movie with as physical producers, and then basically circled her and said, here's the only one.
People think, oh, big budget movies, what a waste. But when you have a big budget, you can hire the talent that you want to hire that is going to give you a great film. That's the great part of a job like mine, to be able to help with putting that team together.
Well, for one thing, I move around a lot. Colombia, Guatemala, the Philippines, Mexico, New Zealand, New Guinea, wherever there's a volcano with an attitude.
Pierce Brosnan, he's been a friend of mine for quite a long time, and I've always really liked his work. And I don't know, the Pierce that I know is very different to the, you know, the 007 character that I guess he's famous for. Early on, I slipped him the script and said, hey, Pierce, you know, take a look at this. Would this interest you if it was offered to you?
He just said, look, I'm doing this movie during the summer. It's called Dante's Peak. Do you want to read it? And if you like it, I'd love you to do it.
Because I didn't want to, you know, make a big thing and say, okay, let's, you know, let me sell Pierce to the studio, and then Pierce to say, no, I don't want to do the movie. So Pierce said, listen, you know, this could be good.
And there was a very, very nervous time there when we were worried whether Pierce would do it or not, and then whether they could fit it in, and Roger and he were friends, and did they really want to work together or not?
You know, we know each other, but we don't really know each other. And we've gotten to know each other in a much more profound way in the making of this movie.
And then Pierce committed also.
Hi, Harry. Hello. Hello, Harry.
Linda, I'd never met Linda before. I'd seen her movies. To be honest, she didn't really, you know, jump to mind when I was thinking about who should play this part.
Actually, when Roger met me, and this is when I was sure he wasn't at all interested in me, he goes, well, you know, I don't know if you could do this. I mean, you've never done anybody normal. You know, like, normal is hard. I mean, normal is normal. Normal is easy, you know? You just bring the life to it. It's pretty straightforward.
You know, something that you keep reminding yourself as a director, don't, you know, judge people off their previous work. Meet them in person, see what they are, see what they've got to contribute, because sometimes, you know, you can be surprised. And Linda was a great example of that. You know, the Linda Hamilton that came in to see me was so absolutely different to the character out of the Terminator. You know, here was this really outgoing, friendly, warm, you know, far from the sort of, you know, macho sort of butch character in a way that she played in the Terminator.
Went through the whole sequence of meetings and then got into a real contractual problem with another film, and we just basically duked it out for 4 weeks, you know, hours and hours on the phone with attorneys and agents, and finally got it.
I think she's a sensational actress, and Pierce and her together, they really hit her off well. They became friends making this film. I think they made a great couple.
You like eggplant parmesan?
For breakfast?
For dinner. I'm inviting you over for dinner to say thank you.
Thanking me for what?
For saving Graham's life and for caring.
It's a date.
Linda's one of the best things to come out of this movie for me. I've made a new friend, a good friend. I love her dearly. I have greatest admiration for her as an actress and as a woman and as a mother.
The greatest delight of this movie has been working with Pierce. He's just such a lovely man, and accessible and honest and funny and willing. And it's been a bit of magic, I think.
We live in the same community. We're both single parents. We both talk about the family unit. And this film is a family film, dealing with a family unit.
And I feel that we have enhanced the film that much more by having a really good chemistry together and a good trust. You know, we're both Malibu people, and there's a certain energy required to be a Malibu person, you know, in a whole likeness that I think serves us really well. And
one of the things that played out that revealed itself in the course of the movie, which, you know, when you cast a movie is not necessarily there, is what sort of chemistry do your players have with each other?
The great thing about the cast for this film, especially the family that we have in the picture, when Pierce and Linda get together with her two children, was like a family. They had fun, they concentrated and then lost concentration and had to get the energy back and got tired and enthusiastic, and it was really more so than any film I've ever been on.
I feel like Linda is like really, she acts like my mom, and Jeremy acts like my brother, and it just feels like we're a whole family.
We do a lot of things together. We wrestle, we jump, we play, we're always playing together, and you know, Linda will give me tips because she's been in the business for such a long time and she's so experienced that I mean, she knows a lot.
They're always up, they're always fun, They're always sweet. They have a slight ups and downs occasionally, but nothing that, you know, they're really adorable, ideal children to work with.
Now that's one of the hard things with children is, you know, you can't motivate them the same way as an adult's motivated. You know, they're doing it for a different reason.
Doing movie after movie after movie, you get a little jaded. You know, it's another fire, it's another explosion, it's another earthquake, it's another this. The kids come onto the set and they look at this forest burning or this lava rushing down or, you know, this pond that they have to row across. It can be simple or it can be whatever, and it's still an adventure. They still, it's an adventure and it's new and it's exciting and it's a first time for them. So it kind of helps the crew and helps us recapture a little bit of that enchantment of what we're doing.
I've worked with kids before, but I've never worked with children that were so sort of keen to be at work. You know, they just loved making this film. I mean, the last day of this movie when we wrapped shooting, these kids were just crying their eyes out. They were so sad this movie was over. And the truth was, you know, we all felt like that.
One thing that was really scary but very exciting was when we were doing a scene where we had to be in a boat and the boat tipped and we all fell in. And I was so scared because all the clothes were really heavy and it like pulled you under. There were waves from the boat and that was pretty scary.
Everything was, you know, we were coming to the end of it. The boat was filling with water. The acid was there eating it away, and we still weren't at the dock, and all hell broke loose.
When I supposedly pushed everybody out of the boat, that was on a scene in Universal Studios. We were by a big lake, and something went wrong, and our boat flipped over. And it looks like I was pushing everybody out of the boat, and everybody just loved that, and they all started laughing, especially Linda.
Our boat just went into the lake. I mean, just, you know, within 5 seconds. And because it's green screen and there's no perspective and everybody's watching the monitor, Roger, and there are all kinds of rescue vehicles around the perimeter of the lake, but Roger is looking at the monitor going, too many waves, too many waves, and like having no idea that the boat is actually sinking with all of us aboard. Situations like that have made me a little bit on guard, you know. It's sort of like, oh, what's next? Famine, you know, locusts.
Quakes are beginning to swarm. Over 2.4.
Gas readings are going up too. It's not good. And that is not good.
Sir, is that the best you can do for us? Yes, sir. All right, thanks very much. I appreciate it. The National Guard cannot be here until tomorrow.
How much time do you think we've got, Harry?
Don't know. Too early to tell. Call the mayor. Have her put the town on alert. I'll call the FAA.
I have a philosophy about casting movies, and that is, whoever you cast in the movie, don't get any character confused with another character. I've been to the movies myself, and halfway through I go like, hang on, which one's which? Even though they can be very different, when you really think about it, there can be sometimes, especially in a sort of, you know, in an ensemble piece, if people aren't very clearly defined, each individual character, it can get confusing for the audience. So what I wanted to do was I wanted to find a group of people that everyone really had a strong personality of their own that would really shine through. And that's what I set about doing, and that's what I think I found in this group of actors. You know, they were a real pleasure to work with these guys. You know, they were, I mean, it wasn't a bad movie to be on too.
This is a smoky quartz crystal, and I had one just like it when I was your age. Very lucky.
You know about this stuff?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just a little bit.
Dr. Dalton's a geologist.
Volcanologist, actually.
You mean like Dr. Spock and Mr. Spock?
Well, kind of, but without the ears, you know?
We did a lot of rewrites on the script from when I first got the script to the final script that we shot. One of the things that I wanted to do was to make the story, I wanted to make the facts about volcanoes accurate. I didn't want it to be, you know, a sort of collection of misinformation. I wanted it to be, you know, accurately correct. I think I felt that the real facts about volcanoes are awesome enough and that you didn't have to exaggerate them to make a, you know, an exciting story.
Once we decided to start the filming process and got our green light, we decided to hire a number of volcanologists, three of them specifically, to guide us through the process to make sure that we were technically accurate.
The first couple people I talked to told me to call David Johnson. David Johnson was the volcanologist we needed. And when I called a number I'd been given, they answered David Johnson Memorial Observatory. And that's when I realized that maybe I wasn't going to speak to David Johnson.
They're a breed unto themselves, these people. A small tribe, as it were, who are fascinated and compelled to go into dangerous situations.
Nobody has survived and been in the middle of many of these events to show what really happens. We usually see them from a distance.
For 3 or 4 days, we couldn't find a volcanologist who was famous, who was alive. We called a couple who had shot some wonderful footage in Japan and in the Philippines. They were dead. And we went through person after person and eventually, of course, found some live volcanologists.
A volcanologist is basically anybody who studies volcanoes as a profession. And volcanologists have many different shades. Some of us study just the rocks or the deposits left from volcanic eruptions. My particular specialty is seismology. I study, the earthquakes and seismic signals generated by volcanoes.
Okay, Harry. Bingo. If this mound's gonna rock and roll, we're gonna know about it.
David Harlow was one of the chief volcanologists monitoring the Pinatubo eruption. And he was the guy that really, put his own job and neck on the line to make a prediction about when that mountain would erupt.
There were pumice balls about that size falling out of the sky, along with this steady rain of ash mud. A typhoon had moved in. It was pitch black. There were lightning strikes that were not ordinary. Even the most violent thunderstorm I've ever been in, we couldn't compare. They were continuous. You'd look on the horizon, these things would come out, and you'd realize that if you were standing there, you'd not only be killed, but you'd be vaporized. And that's because this tremendous column of ash is much like a thunderhead. It builds up tremendous static electricity charges. And so all of this together gave this very eerie, wrong time of the day darkness with all of these biblical phenomena going on. And we, at that time, felt that our, all the requisites of courage had been satisfied, and there was no use being curious because we couldn't see anything anyway, and the best thing was to move down the road about 10 to 15 more miles.
I think David would tell you he was sort of as relieved as anybody and surprised in a way that it went according to what he thought would happen. Probably what he doesn't tell you is that as a result of his predictions, the lives of a couple hundred thousand people were saved.
I enjoyed a lot working with Roger. He was committed to getting all of the scientific details correct. Because of his background in geology, it was very easy to communicate with him about the specifics, and he has a wonderful appreciation for just our science.
When more and more research came in and we spoke to more and more consultants and the script evolved through its different stages, we all realized that a volcano has an entire repertoire that it does.
There are just situations where you're standing there, the ground is like a bowl of jello going like this under you, and you can hear noises thumping, there's steam explosions occurring under your feet. And you would swear if you're taking this and put it on a film that this is faked, but it's real life.
It isn't just lava rushing down a mountain, There are pyroclastic clouds, there are lahars and mud bombs and floods and fires and, just so much fun stuff.
It's absolutely a Disneyland of disaster. There's so many things that we can work with that the mountain does. It creates its own weather. It's got its own lightning with colors to it. I mean, this is out of research. There's footage on this. It's real stuff. We can take it and use it. And part of it is kind of educating people as to what it is. The other part is really using it, taking advantage of the visuals of what this really is.
Because of Roger's commitment to getting, to portraying what volcanoes do, having all the special effects look exactly like what happens during a volcanic eruption, that, you know, I hope it inspires a whole new generation of volcanologists.
There are a lot of little things you do for special effects that to make a movie entertainment. And certainly this is not just, this is just not plain an educational film. It's an entertainment film. But in working in, there's a lot of educational value to the film.
Research shows usually from afar what's happened. We're trying to get inside of that so that the audience can really see and feel the effects of what that is.
We've looked at lots of different scenarios, lots of different things, and what we've done is we've taken all that information and put that into our sort of pot, you know, stirred it around and taken out a story.
Nice little town. And it's so all snug and cozy right against the mountain.
Yeah, just like Pompeii.
Come on, let's unpack her.
In terms of finding a place for this movie, we looked all over Northern California and Oregon and Washington State. We were looking for a small town on the edge of a real volcano. The one that sort of fitted the sort of description of what I was looking for best, I guess, was Mount Shasta, on the edge of Mount Shasta. And then there's another town nearby called Dunning. And while those towns didn't really give the right visual look that I was looking for, they provided me with a lot of information that I could, you know, that I put into the movie. What I was looking for was something that was even more, even closer to the mountain, that felt really hemmed in, with the mountain right up there looming over the town. And I couldn't find anywhere. You know, we looked all over Canada, we looked all over the United States, and we didn't find anywhere exactly like I wanted to find. So then we said, well, okay, let's stop looking for real volcanoes. Let's look for a town that would really work. We can put the volcano in digitally.
We looked at photographs of many different locations. We needed a location of a town, a small town, that we could actually do a lot of physical damage in, that was completely surrounded by mountains, so that the only thing we would have to put into the picture would be the volcano. We did not want to spend the money on putting mountains around every place the camera turned. So wherever the camera shot, we wanted mountains, and we knew we would do the volcano.
We had scouts out for, I don't know how long it was, 2 or 3 months, looking at every possible town. And they came back with 3 or 4 possibilities, and we went and checked those out. And the one that appealed to me most was Wallace, Idaho.
Northwest on Bank Street, going toward what could possibly be an Oktoberfest at the end of this street, sort of, if that area was blocked off with a stage and whatnot. Good chance to, with some elevation, mat in, peak, whatnot. Where I'm thinking possibly of doing a command center motel business there.
It was minus 24 degrees when we woke up. We watched, having breakfast, to break the ice on Lake Coeur d'Alene, and then we walked around Wallace and it was 10 degrees. And I said to Roger, there's no way we're shooting here. And of course, a few months later, we're back, starting shooting June 5th, and on June 8th, it snowed in the mountains. On June 15th, it was 100 degrees and we're wearing shorts.
Well, Wallace was perfect. It had exactly the kind of geographical and historical aspects that the film required.
It really did have the forest coming right down to the edge of the town. It had the advantage that there were a lot of buildings in the town were empty because the town has, you know, it's an isolated town that's fallen on hard times.
It was a town with a completely closed-in feeling, with only one route of escape, which we also needed.
It had this freeway that went right through the town, and yet the town was, you know, we could do what we liked with the town, really.
We met with the town council early on, our location manager, Ken Levine, who was really instrumental in helping to get us the town and keep the town happy, assembled the town council, and we all met with them and basically told them that we were going to be covering their main streets and dumping ash everywhere, and they said, well, oh yeah, Mount St. Helens did that, you know, we're used to that. We know that. As long as you clean it up, it's okay.
We talked to their city council and told them what we wanted to do, and we told them about the problems that we'd you know, they would experience working with us, and also the advantages. And I think they were pretty enthusiastic to have us there.
They said, yeah, we've been there before and we'd love to have you. And I said, what about the people who don't? And they said, we'll take care of that ourselves. We'll police internally. And they did. They were really, really phenomenal.
I mean, when you go to film in a small town, it's both, you know, for some people there's a great economic advantage. For other people there's a lot of inconvenience as they, you know, like to drive around the little town and go to the post office and suddenly they find, you know, they have to walk around the block.
It was a blessing and a curse, I'm sure, for the local people. They were able to see an economic windfall, but at the same time, many people weren't able to get to their stores. They found that their homes, when they got returned from work, was covered in our version of volcanic ash.
I think we got a reception there that was everything from, you know, people were crying to see us go when we left to people who I'm so sure were cheering.
Dante's Peak was just named the second best place to live in the United States. Population under 20,000.
Good for you. What was number one?
I don't know. Some piece of crap town out in Montana. Who cares?
I'll be seeing you.
Okay.
Well, this is Wallace, Idaho. And let me show you on Bank Street. We're turning this town into Dante's Peak. We had booths all the way down the street. We had a stage. We had quite fanfare here that lifted the spirits of the town and made it really fun and vibrant and busy and crowded and colorful. And we're starting the movie off with that feeling to where it's really, we feel it's a town that has a lot of history to it. And it has a sense of upcomingsmanship. It's coming up with tourism, with business. People are coming in. It's got a lot to lose if a mountain goes off. The thing that I like about this town, one of the reasons we chose it, was that it's got such a wonderful character about it architecturally, but the mountains pinch the town totally, all around the town. You can never turn around without sensing that there's a mountain on your shoulder. It's a great feeling for us. It's a vulnerability, and we can see, once we've matted in and done miniature work and model work with this mountain, it'll put it all together, and it will feel that this town is really in the shadow of a massive potential volcano, which in this case does start acting up. If you look beyond the motel, up into that valley is where our Dante's Peak is going to be and where everything emanates from. This set is a building that there was a start here with a part of a building. We added on to it. What we've tried to do through the whole town is take areas that we could blend and add into so that it felt somewhat seamless, and what we did feels like part of the town. It's important for many reasons, so that it feels natural, it feels comfortable, but also when things start coming apart, it feels like part of the town's coming apart, not an add-on. In the attempt to kind of pretty up the town and make it a little more lively, lots of the stores we've added facades, signs. This is a good example. This is all bogus. We've added the store, framing store with all the detail. Our set decorating department did tons of work in these windows. We've dressed many storefronts. All the trees that you see here, phony trees, we've just put these in. The greenery picks it up. We put in awnings on the buildings. We've added signs, added stores. Did some paint jobs, a few facelifts. Our production offices are in that building. It's kind of fun that all our offices are within the set. And then at one point, we're going to take the entire town, well, not the entire town, but a portion of the town, and ash it in. So it's going to feel as though there's like an 8-foot drift of ash that goes up into the storefronts. That'll be from here all the way down for about 3 blocks. We'll just put in forms and the ash as though it had been ashing for several hours, and it just socked in. The corner here is an important corner. A lot happens around here. There's a building across the street that we put up in brick. We built it in real brick. Underneath it, amazingly enough, there's an ATM which is still working. And people go in and we say, well, just don't touch anything, be careful. The interior of these buildings that we pre-broke and smashed and crashed, a lot of that research was out of earthquake research of San Francisco and Los Angeles, just to see what's happened inside when a building is opened up to a sort of a storybook dollhouse. You're just seeing what's happened inside. People that have lived here all of a sudden see a building that looks real, but they can't understand why they can't go inside. When they walk up to the windows and look in, they see an interior that's pre-crashed. Everything is hanging and crashed inside. because eventually this building is going to fall out into the street, and then we'll give them back their ATM. The final phase of this town that we'll see is after the aftermath, when everything's settled down, when we come back to see that a town has actually been leveled, flattened, partially covered with mud, and totally ash-laden. And it'll really look like a lunar landscape. It'll look like a nuclear winter.
Dennis, he put an enormous amount of work into planning how we could use this town and the sorts of buildings that we could build, which buildings could fall, how we would make them fall, how they would tie into the plan, how they'd tie into the models. He was a great asset.
Well, maybe we should move here.
I don't think so. I've done that in a week.
It's nothing. Some animal must have scared me.
Jerry?
How was that?
Action!
We began principal photography in June 1996 in Wallace, Idaho.
Should we like go one, two, three, and then slowly tilt up so you see it just going all up over the top of us? Yeah. All right. I think we should do it more.
Why, Jody, did anything
much,
did anything
100 times better. 100 times better. You buy it. You buy it. You know the trick, you know?
I knew this was going to be a tough movie to make. What I wanted to do was to get around me some of the best people that I've worked with in the past, and Andre is one of those people.
Andre has had to contend with just about everything you could throw at a cinematographer. Low light levels, visual effects, practical effects, shooting dusk for dawn, shooting day for night, shooting night for day.
Andre is a great DP. He's done a lot of very well-known movies. One movie that I really loved the way it was shot was Speed. And it had a lot of energy to the way it was filmed. And when I was looking for a director of photography to do my last movie, I hired him and we shot that movie together. And he, you know, we just got on like a house on fire.
Usually when a picture is rolling, a producer has done his work. You've put it together, you've hired the team, you've created the shooting schedule, the budget, you've, you know, put everyone together. They're all the best people in the business and they're doing their work better than you ever could.
The toughest part about making a movie like this is exhaustion. It's just hard every day, 7 days a week, you know, 14, 18 hours a day to keep, you know, being enthusiastic, to keep being creative, to keep having all the bright ideas and the enthusiasm and, you know, take the army with you. The only thing that keeps me going is that I imagine what it must be like if you're in, say, a war situation where they're firing real bullets at you and it's 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and there is no break, there is no time when you can say, okay, cut, 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 I'm going to my trailer for a rest, you know. There are tougher jobs.
Because we were shooting so much in sequence, the remains of these fallen down buildings and crushed school buses and broken out windows at the local high school had to remain there for weeks on end. And it really did seem as if the town had been destroyed.
You know, one of the things about making movies is that, you know, often the things that you do in a movie are dangerous. And you have to, on one hand, offset the, you know, you've got to judge the risk and you've got to take precautions and make things as safe as you possibly can. Because ultimately, you know, the worst thing that could happen is, you know, if somebody gets seriously hurt.
Safety is one of the biggest concerns on any big special effects picture. Universal, who is doing this picture, fortunately, is very safety conscious.
We were really trying to be safe on this picture. Alona, our producer, is very, very much a part of the safety of our things. It's a big thing with her, and it should be. God bless her for it. You know, so she really took the initiative to let us investigate things and do it as safely as possible instead of just saying go out and do it. She really had a big interest in it and really pushed for the safety. And I think it spread throughout all the departments, as it should be, but it was really an issue.
It wasn't just like something you take upon yourself to do. It was a real issue, and every day was an issue about safety.
You figure out together where the dangerous areas are going to be, what you're going to need to keep the crew and the cast safe, and you set out a game plan just as you do with any other area of the film. Your stunt coordinator is crucial for safety. You rely on him a great deal, and your on-set safety person, you rely on that person. And after that, it's a lot of common sense.
The use of the visual effects has helped tremendously. It's actually decreased the danger in certain areas, but it also has brought it up in areas because we're trying to do things that are so much more extreme.
You know, we had things that went wrong on this movie. You know, we had, there's a sequence where this, where the Suburban goes across a river, and the river was, you know, flowing swiftly enough that this vehicle could get swept away. And one time, with some stunt people in, the water did pick it up and flip it over. And luckily, we had thought that this possibly could happen, and we had scuba gear in there so that the stunt people who were trapped in the vehicle had the ability to be able to breathe underwater until they could be rescued. We also had some special effects people got hurt, quite badly burnt when some things didn't work exactly as they were supposed to be, and a couple of guys got third-degree burns. And things like that, you know, they shake you up a bit and they make you realize, you know, that you do have to be very, very careful, because nobody could have been more careful than we were, and yet things still did go wrong. And these things happen all the time when you're making big, spectacular, you know, movies that where things look like they're dangerous, often they are dangerous.
These are just precautionary measures. We don't want to start a panic.
Did anybody feel that?
Ladies and gentlemen, please remain calm. Please just stay calm.
I felt that.
Just stay calm. Don't push. Please stay calm.
Well, behind here is a city hall. The city hall goes about two-thirds of the way down. We continued the building on another third. The portion of the building that comes out is the part that we built. That's the part that's made out of real brick, as the other one. It's on rocker footings that Roy, the special effects guy, made. We built our building on that with real brick. He's got rams and pushers inside so that when we give the word, he'll push and rock and fold that whole building out into the street.
Ready and action! And one, and two, and three, and four!
It's nice to see your work crumble, you know. Somehow it's just, it went really well. Nice work on everybody's part. Good stunt.
Well, we're doing the part of the evacuation here, and we have all the crowds, about 300 or 400 extras pouring out of the gym. And what we set up here is a couple of cars that take off during the mayhem, do a near miss with our principals, Linda and Pierce, as they run across the street. And you see the configuration that they're in now. They're going to make contact, what we call a T-bone wreck, and shove it right into the school bus. But the nice element to this is we have the principals working right in the foreground, so it's not stunt doubles, it's the real actors. So they'll run across, we'll bring a steady cam with them, showing it's them. As they make their mark, the two cars at speed will crash behind it, probably get broken glass and stuff flying out of the windows. Shove it right into the school bus, you'll be right on the principals, and we'll continue it all in one motion right to their car. Them and 300 or 400 of their closest friends running behind them.
Action!
Just a continuation of all these events that keep happening through the town, that keep driving people and drive the mayhem and, you know, confusion trying to escape.
We're going to wreck this church here. It's rigged to fall down, hopefully, on cue, and it's going to fall down into the street here. Hopefully it's going to fall over towards this school bus here. And we're going to have a whole lot of panic around here.
make it look like there's panic in every direction.
The church steeple itself weighs 60 tons of rock, and it was knocked down on a weak knee system where they would just take out the bottom part of it and it would fall just like a tree. One-shot deal. Again, we're trying to put human element in there. You know, we wanted to. We're quite sure exactly how it was going to work, even though we have a formula for it. So the biggest problem was trying to create people to be amongst it, using lenses and whatnot, so it looked like they were right there, but also so that when they yelled action, everybody wasn't gone, and then the steeple fell and hit the ground. We wanted people in amongst, you know, around it, but obviously in a safe condition.
Shook the high school. It was so good. That was great. Awesome.
It's a good one.
Good, yeah.
Well, where's Roy? Roy should take a bow.
Yes, he should. All right. Here's those. Here's those.
Anybody else? Thank you.
And
we want to, Roger, do we want to move?
All right. Boom, and then steeple. Boom.
That's going great.
And cut! That's a cut! Cut! Cut!
Stay away from it.
Roy Arbogasta, our special effects coordinator, has been providing all the physical special effects, the things that we are not going to be doing through models or through post-production.
One of the most difficult things he had was coming up with some ideas of how we could make the volcanic ash look convincing and make the exploding mountain look convincing. And he put together some tricks with his air cannons that really, you know, was the backbone of making the mountain explosions look very realistic.
We saw some film on what the ash looked like coming down, and it was the trick to find something that would look like the real ash and be safe for everybody to breathe and get in your eyes, and you know, nothing is 100% safe.
I like the ash because I've had experience driving for miles, unfortunately down the only road that was available to us with an ash cloud blowing over the top of us, and just coming back with ash in every orifice of my body, all through my clothes, all through the car.
We went through many, many different materials. Sawdust, we went through gypsum, we went through, we even thought of, you know, flour, wheat flour.
We have samples of the real ash, which is a silica, it's a glass actually, and you can't even get it off of your hands. What we're using is more of a paper product, really.
Like it's a ground up newspaper, so it's actually just cellulose. And it's, that seemed to give us the cleanest bill of health, and it looks great, it's easy to handle, we could get it pretty much flame-proof and not be toxic.
I thought that anything but real ash would not do the trick, but this actually, in many ways, is just as good as the real ash, because the real ash airfall at any distance out is very fine frequently, and it's blows like light flour, and this is the way this kind of stuff did in the scenes where the trucks were moving through and billowing up the ash. Looked very realistic. Color's about right. And on a movie or in a screen, it's gonna look identical. I don't think you'd see the difference.
It's a mess when you're in it, there's no question. It's flaky, it's all over your clothes. You wear masks so you can breathe and goggles and whatnot, just so you don't get too inundated with it. It's very uncomfortable, but it comes off easy, and it's a easy cleanup, so it's really not too intrusive. But like any of those effects, they're, when you work 14 hours in it, it's not fun. It gets long.
We're going to transition into Ash World.
It was in some ways the toughest part of making the movie. It was tough for the crew, it was tough for the actors, and it was sure tough on the town. This stuff got into every crevice you could imagine, and not only your own bodily crevices, but you know, every house in town had this stuff right through it.
Is the shit just coming pouring in or not?
Shit, yes.
Is pouring in.
Okay, cut, cut.
A lot of people have seen footage of Mount St. Helens on TV and seen the ash falling and people with their windshield wipers. Well, when I looked out and saw our crew with 100 people with goggles and air masks on as we shot this with the
with ash flying every place from the volcano, you really began to understand just how difficult the thing we had mounted. That was in the first few weeks.
Everybody's going to be wanting to look like this.
Just pain in the neck. I mean, you read it on the page and you go, yes, volcanic ash. And then you come to do it and it's just, it's tiring. I mean, the first time around you go, great. But then you do it day in, day out.
Glamorous world of filmmaking.
When? When does it start?
It's a little tasty now. I had a little of it with the veal tonight. It's got a little peppery now. I feel like I've got ash in every ear hole. Every orifice of my body.
It was fairly miserable doing it, you know, because you have to wear masks the whole time and then you take the masks off and then you're in it. And it was ground paper and they had all these huge machines around the set which would just spew this stuff out constantly. So that was a bit miserable, but what the heck, you know, nothing comes from nothing. It's just being an actor, that's all.
And it's just evil, nasty, but hopefully it'll work on film. I mean, it's not the only nasty, evil thing I've had to do on screen.
It's the ash.
I don't think I was quite prepared for what it would be like living in a world of ash, post-eruption ash, which we had to create, and which filled many of our sets and many of the skies around our sets.
A major pain in the ash. I'm sick of ash.
In terms of cleaning it up, we had a very good system for cleaning it up. Just down the road happened to be a major cleanup site for the environmental cleanup site, and there was this company there that had these giant vacuum cleaners on trucks, and every night after we'd finished shooting, they would come through the town with their giant vacuum cleaners and just up it would all go, and the next day the town would look like we hadn't been there.
I can't see through the ash. Maybe I should turn the lights on. They are on. Can you make the windshield wipers go faster?
I don't know how.
Stop being wrong.
Don't touch things. You're gonna mess something up.
Like what?
I don't know. Something.
Maybe this wasn't such a good idea.
We, realized that in order to create the repertoire of the volcano, we could not possibly film it live and survive. Most of the people who've tried to do that have died rather quickly. So we would have to create it with special effects. And Digital Domain was the company that we went to. And Pat McClung was chosen as our visual effects supervisor based on his past reputation of all the other great things he's done.
Ilona wanted me to be on the set the first day of shooting. That was something she hammered in the meetings, and she was very persistent about that. And this is mainly to when Roger is shooting these backgrounds, or we call them plates, that we're going to add something to. There may be a situation where we indeed can't add something to a shot because of the way it was shot. There are still some limitations, even with the advent of the new digital technology.
The problem is to convince, is to not convince, but to communicate what's in your mind about how you want it to be to the people who are going to have to put it together. That's the tough bit. Storyboards help and all that, but trying to, you know, get what's in here onto the celluloid, that's the tough bit.
The great thing about Roger is that he's done a visual effects movie, Species, so he had a real good sense of how to do a lot of this type of work, which is unusual to get a director that that understands this. So he was real helpful in generating these sequences, and I would kind of give him my idea on how to do some of these things, and he would ask questions, well, what about this, what about that, what about miniatures versus computer-generated imagery and so forth.
Well, what we're going to do is we're going to make this freeway continue on and join up with that freeway in the digital world, and when the vehicles get up so there, this whole freeway is going to collapse. And then we'll be shooting back the other way as it collapses, and it'll look like it really came down.
Ready, and action!
It's a crime to show how we really do it.
Good job.
Thank you.
Greg, strap it on. Usually try to be just right. Yeah.
It depends who it is.
All right. Exactly. Perfect. You can't do better than perfect.
You know what? The unwrap is going to collapse, and then the freeway is going to go with it. So we shot a plate of this on-ramp, of this section that Dennis built. So we're going to add the rest of the freeway in miniature collapsing. And actually, that's going to be a pretty straightforward shot. We put a green screen up in front of the cars so we could get them matted, so we could see their movement later, so we could composite that into the rest of the scene. And we use green because it's a very narrow bandwidth of color, and it's very easy to separate it later and put anything behind it we choose. We're doing this with a We're adding the freeway collapse in quarter scale, which is quite a large model. And what we usually do to these shots, this one happens to be a locked off. It's one of the few locked off shots. In other words, it's just the camera's locked. It's not panning around. What we'll do is we'll actually shake this digitally later to make it look like there's an earthquake. We'll add all the stuff collapsing, cars falling, and what have you. And it'll be totally convincing. You won't know it's a model. This type of show lends itself to miniatures. This was my basic approach. There's a volcano. It explodes, and that's like a great candidate for a miniature right there. The size we're looking at is probably about 100-foot footprint. Basically, the base of the mound is going to be about 100 feet wide, and it'll come up to a peak about 20 to 25 feet tall. And it'll be built, basically, it'll be built after the explosion. The whole top will be built, removed at that point. And we'll actually then put a new top on. And the reason we do that is we can do all the shots of the pristine mountain. And then at the end of the schedule, we literally will blow this thing up, shooting it at very, very, very high speed to get the mass and the huge amounts of debris coming out of this. And it's going to be something we can really reset. We'll do it once, see what it looks like, put it all back together again, and then shoot it off again as many times as we need to.
Since we're emulating a plume volcano, which shoots a lot of volcanic ash, again like Mount St. Helens, you've got 5 10-inch air mortars, which are just large air-driven cannons pointed skyward in an array that's semicircular. They're loaded with the debris, a dust debris, which ejects about 150 feet into the air under air pressure. The tricky part comes trying to sequence those cannons with the other elements, which involve a fire element with pyrotechnic black powder bombs and gasoline, and debris mortars, also driven by black powder bombs. The result is that it looks like a volcano in the way a volcano would erupt.
We're creating explosions completely in the computer. We're also using pieces of real explosions to mat into and combine with our digital work. This is just one element of what goes into the whole finished thing. There'll be a lot of computer work as well as this.
Visual effects have always been basically something you just can't do physically. And in the old days, if we needed a train wreck, you really couldn't wreck a train. I mean, although films of recent have done that, you couldn't get a trestle, let's say a wreck a train up on top of a trestle, because it would cost so much and it would be so dangerous. So we do it in miniatures, and miniatures were really the first sort of visual effect that was created, and eventually composite photography. So every time you do that and make it a little more realistic, that stretched somebody's imagination, starting from the writer to the director. And as we get better and better at it, we can do more and more seamless effects that people just had never seen before.
In the case of the dam, it took, I think, something like 4 months to build. The enormous construction of this dam and the water delivery system took a long time to build. I think it took 4 months. It cost a couple of $1 million just to build the set.
What I have here is a 680,000 gallon tank. It's been manufactured, bolts together, has about 9,000 bolts in it, and it's The concept here is to put 7 million pounds of water, or 680,000 gallons of water up here, and allow it to come out a pair of tilting gate doors that will average about 100,000 gallons a minute down this river. The tank itself has been built on top of scaffolding, and it's been colored into a gray tint to look more like a volcanic ash. The water itself takes approximately 1 hour to pump up here, and we can recycle it up and down the river in 3 hours. It'll take 6 minutes to run all the water out of the tank down the river. That's a pretty fast shot considering all the effects and everything else that has to happen in the running of it. Along the way, we're going to be adding in debris, different types of sawdust, small cut-up miniature logs to simulate large trees, and creating a torrent of water down on set. We're going to be moving 700,000 gallons from this tank to a receiving tank of 800,000 gallon tank 500 feet away and stopping it in 1 minute. And that'll be the biggest dump tank in film history.
If you're going to put together a big stunt like that, the last thing that you want to hear is, well, one camera jammed, or the camera jammed, or I'm sorry I got the wrong exposure, or I'm ready when you are, and or all of those excuses that I've heard when you've had big effects go off and somebody, you know, freaks out and something got screwed up. So what I wanted to do was I wanted to first of all cover every angle that I could possibly want to shoot this thing from, and then double up so that if anything did go wrong, and things did go wrong, I think three of the cameras that we had rolling out of the 11 cameras that I had on it failed to operate correctly, and I didn't get any footage out of those cameras. So film and cameras are the cheap part of making something, doing something on a very big scale like this. That was a one-take shot. If I didn't like that, it would have meant coming back again in a few weeks' time after they'd rebuilt it all.
If you want something that no one's ever seen on film before, Digital Domain is the place to go. They have impeccable standards. They want to put on film the best, the most realistic, the most exciting, the most dynamic, and the most impressive visual effects you've ever seen, but their major goal in this film is to make sure that you don't know that they're a visual effect. That there's not one moment where the audience stops and says, oh, that's incredible CGI work, or that's an incredible miniature. We want, and Digital Domain wants, the visual effects in this film to be seamless.
You know, one of the things that I find very hard as a filmmaker to do is to sit through my movies with an audience. It's like you do the movie as best you can, and once it's finished, it's sort of like, you know, a little bit what I imagine childbirth would be like. You don't exactly want to go through it again and again and again. Once it's like, there's the baby, that's it, guys. Take that and run with it, you know. Once I've made the movie, I don't want to see it again for 10 years.
This is really just one of the most teamwork-laden, teamwork-intensive films that I've ever been on, because it's so big.
I'm sure in 10 years from now I'll be happy to take the smaller ones, but as long as they let me do the big ones for a few more years, I'll do them.
I want to do this till I die. I love this. I mean, you get to travel, there's great food, great people, you see yourself on TV. You get paid. It's fun.
It is the greatest, especially when you can invite all your friends to come with you and say, hey, just jump in these cars. We're going to wreck some cars and break some things up. And at the end of the day, we're all going to go home, and it'll be great.
It's fun. Once it's over, it's fun. Oh, it's fun doing it, and then it's fun. If it all works well, it's great. But, you know, we always have our fingers crossed until it's done, until it's finished.
We had a lot of fun making this movie. It was a tough movie to make, but we also had a lot of fun. And while I think the day that I finished shooting it, I thought, I never want to see another movie camera again. Within 2 weeks, I was thinking about, yeah, I'd love to be back there behind the saddle and in the saddle again. I missed it. It was a very intense 6 months making this film.
Sam! Sam!
Mom, it's Harry! He's alive!
It's good to see you.
You said about taking us fishing.
Sure did.
That's great.